Thank you. Good evening and good morning and good afternoon, everyone that are watching this lecture series. Today we have a Professor Johanna Squass. He's a professor for theoretical meteorology at Leipzig University, Germany, and he's there since 2011. He worked at four of the main climate modeling centers in France, Germany, UK, and the USA. His expertise is in the role of clouds in global climate change, especially the impact of anthropogenic aerosols on clouds. And Johanna studies these using atmospheric modeling from local to global scales and from satellite observations. He served as a lead author for the sixth assessment report by the Intergovernmental Panel for Climate Change. He was also a member of the ICCP, and we are very thankful to him for accepting this to give this lecture, and we wholeheartedly welcome Professor Johanna Squass to deliver his talk. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Tara, for the invitation and everybody hosting this seminar series. That's very kind, and I think a great opportunity also to share a couple of thoughts. So I chose the title of aerosol cloud effective radiative forcing. So that is the climate effect by aerosol cloud interactions. And since this is targeting young scientists, I chose to try and do this in a theoretical framework. So what I'm trying to do is develop the concepts of aerosol cloud effective radiative forcings. Because I'm of the opinion that our field sometimes lacks the mathematical rigor that sometimes is, can be very helpful in understanding the different phenomena. So if I may, what I wanted first to talk about is the question, what is climate? And I want to develop what we exactly mean by effective radiative forcing. And then as a second point, I want to just briefly say also cloud interactions in a nutshell, but that's a recurring topic, obviously, in this lecture series, so this can be brief. And then I dig into the concepts of the effective radiative forcing. And only at the end, I really show some results. These are sort of summarizing a couple of studies looking at the change in cloud cover and cloud liquid water path from fundamental observational evidence, and also talk about the challenges which we have here. So what you see here is an image by the Meteosat satellite, the geostationary European geostationary satellite. That's why it is above the Greenwich Meridian. And you see what is the image that is taken at local noon in the green in 600 nanometer. That's the visible channel. And you also see, but then transfer to the visible, so it's our eyes are sensitive to it, the 1.8 micrometer channel, which is the infrared channel. And the point here is you see clouds in either of them. So much of the variability of the Earth radiation budget is due to clouds. And because you see them, that means they matter for the energy budget of the planet in both of these spectra. And that's interesting enough to also think about what does their impact on radiation, what makes it change in a changing climate. So first question, what is climate? And as I said, or also as Tara introduced, I am professor for theoretical meteorology. So if you don't mind, let me develop what I think about in a theoretical concept in a framework of mathematical equations. And if you want, climate really can be defined by the Earth energy budget and a climate change, obviously, by a perturbed Earth energy budget. But let's first look at the Earth energy budget and look at the net radiation. And as I said earlier, as we saw also in that in that satellite image, it has two constituents, two components. One is the one is in the solar spectrum, visible radiation, and the other is in the infrared spectrum, the radiation due to heat. And the net thing is R, the net radiation, and what's coming in the daily average is the solar constant S0, approximately 1,360 watts per square meter, the solar constant. And then the absorbed solar radiation is 1 minus the albedo, so the bit of sunlight which we see when we watch from space, when we watch, for example, from that Meteosat satellite. That fraction is, of course, not useful for climate, but it is reflected. So only the fraction that's absorbed, 1 minus what's reflected, is relevant for the climate. And that's balanced by the terrestrial radiation, which can be written in terms of the surface temperature to the fourth power, Stefan Boltzmann constant, 5.667 10 to the power of minus 8, 5.6678 watts per square meter per Kelvin to the fourth power. And then we scale it because, in a sense, it's not the surface temperature but the brightness temperature that is relevant for radiation. So we just scale down the effect of the surface temperature by the emissivity epsilon, which is, in essence, the greenhouse effect. So I hope and guess that's known to all of you. Now let's look at the change. And the change, what I didn't say, what I meant to say, is there are two constants, solar constant and a Stefan Boltzmann constant. And then there's four parameters of the climate system: the net radiation, the planetary albedo, the emissivity, the greenhouse effect, and the surface temperature. And so we can write that net radiation budget as a function of the three other parameters, which is albedo, emissivity, and surface temperature. And in essence, in that sense, surface temperature is climate. So if you do it and we want to look at the perturbation of the Earth radiation budget, then that's the way to do it. We take the fundamental derivative with respect to all the three parameters which we have here. So that's the sensitivity of the radiation budget to albedo times changes in albedo, its sensitivity to the greenhouse effect times changes in the greenhouse effect, and its sensitivity to climate times climate change. And a couple of these derivatives, or all of them, really we can evaluate because it's a simple equation. We can simply take the derivative. The derivative of R with respect to alpha is minus solar constant divided by 4. The derivative of R with respect to epsilon, the partial derivative, is simply minus sigma at the surface temperature to the fourth power. And the only one where we really have to use our brains a bit is the derivative of R with respect to surface temperature, which is 4 times minus 4 times epsilon sigma Ts to the third power times delta surface temperature change. And now that is the fundamental equation that allows us to define forcing and feedback. And first of all, let us consider what are these terms, this delta alpha, delta epsilon, and delta Ts. Delta Ts is maybe easiest, that's the climate change. But let's consider delta epsilon maybe first. And we have some forced changes in the greenhouse effect, that is in particular, of course, a change in carbon dioxide concentrations, the CO2 concentrations, but also, of course, the changes in concentrations of other greenhouse gases, methane, nitrous oxide, etc. So that's the forced component of the change in greenhouse effect. And in particular, it's the change of greenhouse effect with a change in the concentration of CO2 times the change in CO2. And then we also have We also have the response of the greenhouse effect to surface temperature changes, that's the feedback. And that's changes in particular of the water vapor concentration, the specific humidity QV, which is described, but that we don't do today, but could, of course, describe it in terms of the Clausius-Clapeyron equation. Could also be changes in clouds that, of course, have a greenhouse effect. Could be changes in the lapse rate, because the greenhouse effect is due to the fact that the atmospheric temperature decreases with altitude. Could be also the carbon cycle feedback and others. So there's the epsilon contribution, contribution to the delta epsilon due to feedbacks, which is the change in epsilon with temperature times temperature change. So that aspect which is dependent on temperature change. That's the feedback aspect. That aspect that is not dependent on temperature change, that's the forcing aspect. And then we also see changes in delta alpha in the albedo, and we have the forced changes in albedo, and that's, of course, today's topic in particular. That is the changes in the aerosol concentration, just A for aerosol, the changes in its concentration via the aerosol radiation interactions, and what we are going to look at via aerosol cloud interactions, but also land use changes, for example, do a forced change in the albedo, and that's the forced change in alpha, the change in albedo due to changes in aerosol in particular, and then times changes in aerosol. And then we also have feedbacks, that is the response of albedo to surface temperature changes, and it's in particular changes to the surface albedo as snow and sea ice melt, but it also changes in clouds in particular, and also aerosol feedbacks exist, so that's the feedback component to this delta alpha term. Okay, and then we'll see, I mean, there's two components that dictate this delta epsilon, and there's two components that dictate this delta alpha. And if you combine this entire equation, then what we see is delta R has, first of all, the forced changes. That's the forced change due to the aerosol change and the forced change due to the CO2 change. Yes, just replacing this delta alpha forced by this term that's written in terms of the aerosol change. And this delta alpha, delta epsilon, delta greenhouse effect forced, written by expanding it and just considering the greenhouse effect due to CO2. And then there was this contribution delta alpha feedback. So that had this term delta TS in it, which I take out of the bracket here. And that's this term. Then there was this delta epsilon feedback, which was this one. Again, taking this delta TS out of the bracket. And then the fundamental feedback, the Planck feedback, as it is called, which was present in the previous equation already. Okay, so then you see basically what we obtain is nice and simple. It is a linear equation. It has this delta R, the change in radiation budget, has one component due to which is relevant for which the change in surface temperature is relevant, and then the force changes. And this entire thing in a simplified way is called feedback parameter. And this entire thing in a simplified way is called the net effective radiative forcing, the total effective radiative forcing. And then you see linear equation. We can write the net radiation, delta R on one axis and the delta T on the other axis. And you see it's a linear equation. And then we can diagnose and we can see how this actually works is that over time, the energy imbalance is reduced down to zero again as the temperature change is increased. So at short time scales, this is given by the forcing, and at long time scales, this is down to zero as delta TS evolves. And that's what it is here from a simplified, I mean, just schematic from climate models. In year one, we get a certain temperature, a certain reduction of the imbalance and a certain temperature change, and then it increases the temperature change if the forcing is positive as the delta R goes down to zero. And that can be fitted by a straight line, and then you see simplified is delta R is the epsilon, the capital E effective forcing plus lambda feedback parameter times delta TS, and that now as a function of time. So at time zero, delta TS is zero and R is the effective forcing. And then at time infinity, R is zero, delta R is zero, and the temperature change is the climate sensitivity, equilibrium climate sensitivity, that's minus the forcing, effective forcing divided by lambda. And you can diagnose the feedback parameter. So I thought that might be useful. I'm looking forward to any feedback from you, whether you find it useful or not. You don't see it in every curriculum. And so that's why I thought it might be useful. You see a rigorous definition on what's forcing and what's feedback and how exactly to compute it if you want. Now let's look at a couple of concepts when it comes to aerosol cloud interactions in a nutshell. And then in point three, I'm again going to define them more rigorously by equations. But first, let's look at two scenarios, two different atmospheres on the left-hand side, an atmosphere that is not influenced by anthropogenic aerosols, and on the right-hand side, an atmosphere that is influenced by anthropogenic aerosols. So if we consider cloud forms, first of all, they might look similar, unless there is other boundary conditions changed as well. But then if you look at the two different atmospheres that are subject to different concentrations of aerosols, then we see that cloud contains fewer aerosol, fewer condensation nuclei, and so fewer droplets, and that polluted cloud contains more droplets. And that has a consequence for a couple of additional processes. So if you like, that's the main thing. This thing is the main thing. More aerosols, more droplets. The droplet number concentration is enhanced. That is the fundamental thing that happens. That's the first thing and fundamental thing that happens. In former times, the older ones among us recall the first indirect effect. Nowadays, we call it the radiative forcing due to aerosol cloud interactions. But then processes in the clouds, and by the way, one other thought, this is when the cloud forms. That is the cloud source. At the cloud source, this is what's relevant. But then a couple of things happen to the cloud, and this is to do with the cloud sink processes. I mean, the end of the lifetime of a cloud. This is at the beginning of the lifetime of a cloud. What's at the end of a lifetime of a cloud? The cloud might lose its water due to precipitation, and then we'll see later also what how formally, but that if it's a liquid cloud, this precipitation sink is slowed down, and so the in particular horizontal extent of the cloud might be enhanced. So that's the average horizontal extent of the cloud might be enhanced because the sink process is slowed down. But then some clouds do not dissolve due to precipitation, but they do dissolve due to mixing. Simply, they lose their water because they mix with dry air, and that mixing is enhanced. And that enhanced mixing might lead to a shrinking of the clouds, in particular for stratocumulus clouds. It might lead to a shrinking if it's driven by cloud top entrainment and mixing. But also lateral cloud entrainment and mixing is affected, and both of them might lead to the fact that the cloud is reduced in its water extent. And that has then the consequences for climate because it changes the solar flux, the albedo of the cloud. It also changes the greenhouse effect, but I'm not dwelling on this because I only have 3/4 of an hour. So now let's do this a bit more formally again and consider the effective forcing due to aerosol cloud interactions, the effective forcing capital E due to ACI aerosol cloud interactions. And as we said, that's about the change in the radiation in the top of atmosphere radiation budget due to a change in the aerosol, and capital R again the radiation budget, and alpha now the aerosol concentration. And its perturbation, and it's a relative to perturbation, the perturbation divided by its mean, or the logarithmic perturbation. It's the delta alpha due to anthropogenic aerosol emissions divided by alpha, or delta ln alpha anthropogenic. And when it comes to aerosol cloud interactions, what matters is the perturbation due to the change in the cloud particle number concentration, NC. And it turns out most plausible is that the change in radiation is with a relative change in the drop concentration or ice crystal concentration, but we'll focus on liquid clouds, so in which case the cloud particle concentration is drop concentration. But of course, the same works for ice crystals, except the some of the concepts are not quite as straightforward. For homogeneous freezing, the same thing applies. For heterogeneous freezing, it does not. There is different effects on the ice number concentration. Anyway, let's turn to liquid clouds again and see there is a change in the radiation due to a change in number concentration of the clouds. And then there's a change, of course, in number concentration of the clouds due to a change in the cloud active aerosol in the CCM. Okay, and here I wrote the fundamental derivative again, but if we expand it, then we can expand it in terms of the four bulk properties of clouds, the four bulk properties of clouds that are relevant to the radiative fluxes. One, obviously, is drop number concentration. And if you just look at the relative change, I mean, the partial derivative, how does the radiation budget change only as the drop number changes, everything else held fixed. That's the partial derivative of R with respect to relative change in NC. And that's the what we call the radiative forcing due to aerosol cloud interactions, formally called first indirect effect, the RFACI radiative forcing due to aerosol cloud interactions. But then all these processes, as I said, the sink processes in particular, precipitation, evaporation, mixing, they act also on the other three key radiative properties, which is the cloud fraction F, the horizontal extent of a cloud, the cloud liquid water path L, that's to first order, that just the square proportional to the square of the thickness of the vertical extent of a cloud. And then also the cloud top temperature, where I'm going to not looking at this much further because I do not have the time to look into the terrestrial spectrum, but in the terrestrial spectrum, this matters. And if you look at these three remaining key cloud quantities, cloud cover F, liquid water path L, and drop number concentration ND, then you can have a look at the distribution of these. And you see they're pretty heterogeneous. Yeah, this is for liquid clouds only, the clouds which are relevant for the liquid cloud aerosol cloud interactions. And you see there's a couple of regions where they are prevalent and others where they are not. And then liquid water path, large in the storm tracks, and you see quite a distribution here. And you see also typical values. That might be between 20 is very thin clouds, but starting from 20 or so to 100 something on average. And you also see the drop number concentration. There's some things over the deserts where we might not trust very much, but we see a clear land-sea contrast, which we would expect. And we see the large concentration close to where we expect much of the sources of aerosol and at the adjacent continents. Over the oceans adjacent to the continents. That's, of course, also pretty plausible. And you see the numbers. It's of the order of a few dozens to a few hundred per cubic centimeter. Okay, how does it matter for radiation? Let's have a look. What matters for radiation is the cloud optical thickness. That is, how much is the radiation dampened on its way through the atmosphere, and in particular on its way through the cloud. And so it's a thickness, somehow, if you like, it's a length, but then that length is not even in a unit of length, it's unitless, because it is basically just the dampening of the light as it travels through a cloud. So that's a key parameter when it comes to the effect on radiation. And one can compute it as a function of these three key cloud variables, or rather, because that's only where a cloud is, so cloud fraction doesn't matter, it's only where the cloud X is. So it can be expressed in terms of these two key cloud quantities, which is a droplet number concentration and the liquid water path. And there's a couple of further parameters. There is, if you look into a cloud and look into a cloud volume, a certain cloud volume, small volume, what we in theoretical meteorology call an air parcel, then what we're interested in is the size distribution of the cloud droplets. That's the radius or the number in each radius class as a function of the radius, the size distribution. And typically we try to avoid complications, so not the full size distribution, but just a certain width parameter. And in radiation, one can define an effective radius and of course volume mean radius. And the two are related by a K, a parameter that is relevant, that is large for a large droplet spectral width, droplet spectrum width, and small for small ones. And then further, what we need is the density of water, which is constant, 1,000 kilograms per cubic meter. And we need the condensation rate, that's how much liquid condenses per altitude range. And it's just a function of pressure and temperature. But what in essence we get here when we compute it, and if you like, I can send you a paper which explains how to derive this here. The cloud optical thickness is a strong function of the liquid water path, and it is a relatively weak function of this spectral width and of the drop number concentration. One further down the road is to consider optical thickness, but then what really matters is albedo, as we discussed earlier in the when we talked about the Earth radiation budget. In a simplistic two-stream approximation, scattering only forward or backward, then we need to know what fraction is scattered downward and what is upward, or what is forward and what is backward scattered. And this is this G asymmetry parameter. And if you like, for cloud, for spherical liquid cloud droplets of typical size, we can maybe take this as approximately constant. So the cloud albedo is the fraction of sunlight reflected backwards, AC, the cloud albedo. And in the two-stream approximation, can be written like this. And a nice derivation of all this is in this paper, Boren, 1997. So again, the change, we're interested in the change in the albedo. And you see that's due to a change in cloud optical thickness. And I'm not really going with you through the algebra, taking the derivative of this one. If G is a constant, it's just algebra. You can have a look that this is now the derivative of AC with respect to tau C. And then you see, then you can simplify it by, again, replacing the definition of AC into it. And at the end, what you see is the relative change in cloud albedo with a relative change in optical thickness is 1 minus cloud albedo. It's a simple expression which we get. Let's proceed. Take this result here from the two-stream approximation, and then translating optical thickness, which is really to us an auxiliary in cloud physics, it's an auxiliary quantity. We're really not measuring. It's not a physical. We don't have physical intuition and physical concepts. We also don't in climate models, in atmospheric models. We only compute cloud optical thickness in order to compute radiation. It's nowhere else in the equation. So what really matters is the basic cloud quantities, liquid water path, drop number concentration, also spectral width, for which we have intuition and which we want to understand. So let's replace this tau C by these quantities. Since it's a relative change only, things become easy because then the derivative becomes easy. And you see the relative change in cloud albedo with a relative change in drop number is 1/3 times 1 minus the cloud albedo. So what do we see? The cloud albedo is a number between 0 and 1. 0 if the cloud is completely black, 1 if it's completely white. But in reality, it's in between. It might be about 0.5, 0.6 or so for a typical cloud. Anyway, this is a positive number. And so what you see is as the drop number concentration increases, we get an increase in the cloud albedo. So the cloud becomes more reflective. Yeah, and we see a relative change, and here's a relative change as well. So that's the fundamental change. As the drop number increases, the albedo increases. That's the fundamental effect of aerosols via drop number changes on clouds, and that's the Toomey effect or radiative forcing due to aerosol cloud interactions. Similar, the dependence on K, on the dispersion parameter, again, you see albedo increases as the dispersion increases. Yeah. Now, let's talk about briefly later what we actually expect for K to happen. Not so much, really. This is a strong change. This is not so much of a change. But still, an effect exists, and it's called the dispersion effect. And then you see what happens if liquid water path increases, and you see that's much larger. Yeah, much larger, the effect, compared to these effects here. The question, of course, is, does liquid water path change a lot or not? That's another question which we need to know. But if it changes, then we have a strong change in the albedo. It's much more responsive to changes in liquid water path than to changes in drop number concentration, as you see here. And then finally, also cloud fraction was the other fundamental parameter. And the scene albedo, if you look at broad scene, if you look up, I don't know whether you have clouds in the skies you're looking up, but if I look up here, I have a couple of clouds. There's clear sky and there's cloudy sky, and the clear sky is 1 minus the cloudy sky. That's a clear sky fraction, and I have a clear sky albedo, and I have cloud fraction, and there I have cloudy sky albedo. A subtle difference between the AC, the cloud albedo, and the ACLD, the cloudy sky albedo. This one is measured above the cloud. This one is measured at the top of the atmosphere. It's a subtle, but in practice, it's important. You need to account for it. What happens between the cloud top and the top of the atmosphere? Okay, that given, the cloud adjustment is simple. Does not make sense to take a relative change here, as you see, but you need to change the linear, look at the linear change, and you see it is simply the difference in cloudy sky albedo and clear sky albedo. And here's a cloud box, and you see, that's how you can define the change in albedo due to the change in cloud fraction. Virtually always, the cloud is brighter than the surface. So virtually always, this is a positive number. In very rare cases, this might not. If above fresh snow, for example, you might introduce actually a negative number here. But in general, it's a positive number. It's a very strong effect. If the cloud fraction changes, it's a very strong effect on the radiation budget. And I think I have 15 minutes remaining. And in these 15 minutes, I'm going to talk about what really happens and can we learn about these fundamental terms. Can we learn about it from data? That's what I wanted to do. And let's first look into this here, the Toomey effect. What's the change in albedo with change in drop number concentration? That's given here, but what's really the change in drop number concentration with the change in aerosol? That's, where do I have it? This beast here. That's this term here, the middle term, the delta LNND with delta LN alpha. That's a key uncertainty. You see, that factor is in every factor when it comes to computing the effective relative forcing. This is a key uncertainty. The aerosol perturbation, anthropogenic aerosol perturbation, is an important factor as well. That anthropogenic aerosol perturbation factor, I'm not going to talk about here. It's an important uncertainty. We can try and get it from trend, from different comparing different regions, etc., and of course from models. And typically, that's what I do. I take it from models. But this term here, we hope to be able to infer from data. But what is it? And we have tried hard in the past. Many of us have tried hard to get it from data. The point is, you can get it from aircraft, but then it's you can get virtually what you like. You can get from aircraft, also from ground-based remote sensing. My colleagues here in Leipzig at the TROPOS, the Leibniz Institute for Tropospheric Research, they are fantastic people when it comes to LIDAR, and they have nice new ways to get the drop number from LIDAR, but it's very, very tricky to get from point measurements or column measurements, even long time series. So what we try is getting from satellite, huge statistics, but we do know we did mistakes in the past. What I think is coming closer to reality is the study by Otto Hasekamp, which he, with a few of us, published 2 years back. That's what we did before. Aerosol optical depth, that's the, like the cloud optical depth, the turbidity of the atmosphere due to aerosol now, and then the drop number concentration. That's what you see. That's what you see as a joint histogram between the two quantities over global oceans. Can have many points, and then you can do a regression, and there's options for regression. There's this this dashed line here. That's when you take the regression through all these average points here, all the white points. Or you can also optimize by acknowledging that the sensitivity of the satellite retrievals at very low AOD gets less and less useful. And so one can optimize it and discard the very thin, the very clean atmospheres to come up with, this parameter, this from this regression, this is the parameter in question, the delta LNND, this is logarithmic scale, again, logarithmic, over delta LN aerosol, and the aerosol alpha is now this AOD here, and that's the quantity which we are after. But what Otto was able to do, he analyzed the this is typically from a passive remote sensor MODIS instrument. But he analyzed another instrument, Polder, that also measures polarimetry. So in addition to just the reflectance, he also has the polarimetric information, additional information from which he was able to infer the Kalm cloud condensation nuclei, Kalm CCN, NCCN, the Kalm NCCN concentration, which is more pertinent to the actual, a better approximation to the actual CCN that's relevant for the clouds. And you see this regression coefficient increases, which really means proportional to this, the forcing increases. Yeah, this is this, again, this term, RFACI, that thing maybe we simply get from the simple equation which I showed, or we can also compute it from radiative transfer computation, but this is the thing in question here. And if we take this 0.45, we get a certain value, and here Otto took the 0.66 for this number here, took this from radiative transfer computation and this from models to get a radiative forcing, which is large. And actually, I think it had quite an influence also on the IPCC assessment, which you know is -1 watts per square meter for the ERFACI, for the effective radiative forcing. So then didn't fully make it into the assessment, but I think took it towards the more negative side. Okay, I didn't show the Köhler equation, which is behind it, but let me show for the sink processes a few equations. And one thing is the condensational growth of cloud particles. That's from the steady state solution of the diffusion growth of droplets. And we have the diffusion coefficient for water vapor and the heat conduction away from the droplet. And we have the heat conduction coefficient. And if you do this and feed it in, I mean, the steady state of the diffusion growth and then latent heat release and then conduction away from the droplet, then the heat is taken away and in steady state you can solve it and come up with this in terms of R, the droplet radius. And I don't derive it here, it's a couple of quantities in here. So either you see it in one of the other lectures in this course or you ask somebody or me how to derive it if you like. But what's the point is, dr dt is proportional to 1 over r. It's dr dt 1 over r. So what does it mean? The increase is larger for smaller droplets. Yeah, so the small droplets grow faster than the large ones. And that is, means a narrowing of the size spectrum and a reduction in k as the droplets increase. And if you shift towards smaller droplets, the entire thing, then the reduction in K is faster. Now that's the thing, and Leon Daum is the classical thing on this dispersion effect. And you see there is a dispersion effect due to this condensational growth of particles, reduction in K. But it turns out this effect seems not to be overly large when you quantify it. I didn't really in detail here. And then the sink process, the precipitation formation, the autoconversion of cloud droplets to form rain. That has to consider how each particles fall. The particles fall with a certain terminal fall velocity. It's a monotonic function of R. If as long as the flow is laminar, then the fall of droplets is proportional to the square of their size. And if it's turbulent, it's proportional to the square root of their size. And what matters is the relative velocity of two particles. And that can also be a function of turbulence. So let's just keep V, the fall velocity of two particles with radius R and R prime. And the volume in which the two might collide is the sum of their surfaces and the difference of their velocities times the time. So that's a relative distance of the two. And that's the and that's the surface that they both cover. And then we have a certain coagulation efficiency. And in total, we get a mass conversion to rain. So the change in mass over time due to this process is given by the mass of the droplets that are collected times the volume, which we defined, times the size distribution, times this efficiency. Again, I mean, the fundamental fundamental cloud physics, which hopefully you know about, because this was far too fast to be understandable. Anyway, the result is here we have a dependence on R monotonic. Here we have a square. Here we have a cube dependence on R. So in total, we have a very strong dependence, R to the power of 5 or whatnot. A strong dependence on droplet size, and that leads to the cloud lifetime effect. How important is it? Let me talk about this in a minute. The entrainment mixing, there I did not have the time, because in order to explain this from equations, what we need to do is consider the long wave spectrum, the infrared spectrum of radiation, the cloud top rates of cooling, and we see that's a function of ND, but we didn't see it today. Because it's only 45 minutes. And also cloud droplet fall velocity, as we saw, is a function of ND. So the cloud top liquid water is a function of ND, and that's a further effect on cloud top cooling and turbulence. So the entire thing means that the mixing at cloud top, and we could see with other means also at the sides of clouds, is a function of the drop number. So there is an adjustment in also that sink process due to turbulent mixing. And the first one who demonstrated this from LES simulations was Andy Ackermann. And he showed that the liquid water path with droplet concentration can increase or decrease. And he showed it's a function of how dry is the air that's mixed into the cloud. And it's, of course, also a function on how important is the autoconversion, the rain formation, for the lifetime of the clouds. Yeah, and then finally, what is it? How large is the This term, the change in liquid water path with the change in cloud number concentration. And you saw, I had two arguments. The lifetime effect, the sink, if a cloud has its sink due to autoconversion, then we expect this to be reduced, so the liquid water path to increase. If a cloud has its sink due to evaporation mixing, we expect the opposite. And that's results by Ed Grisbeard. He looked at this from satellite data, from microwave retrievals for the cloud liquid water path. And again, the same as I typically use the MODIS drop number concentration joint histogram. And he sees a behavior which is funny. First, an increase, and a positive covariation of liquid water path and drop number, and then a decrease. Yeah, the overall linear thing is this thing here is negative. Overall, it's a decrease in liquid water path as cloud number increases. But if you only look at low droplets until about 30, then we get a regression coefficient which is positive. And if you only look at high drop number, that's this one here, then we see a decrease. And also, of course, from drop number and liquid water path, the third quantity, which is the droplet effective radius, is redundant with the two. So we can draw an isoline, and for example, an isoline of drop size, effective radius of 15 micrometers. And here are the larger droplets, here are the smaller droplets. And since the autoconversion, the precipitation formation, is a very strong nonlinear function of the effective radius, it is much more efficient as the droplets are larger. So these clouds tend to be precipitating. These tend to be not precipitating. So their lifetime is dictated by the entrainment mixing. And so it's consistent. We now have more questions with this, but at least it's consistent. Clouds that tend to precipitate, they tend to increase liquid water path as drop number increases, a positive term here, and else it's a negative term. And Velletol, he did analysis of many tracks, ship tracks in particular, but also industry tracks and volcano tracks. And he looked at this quantity, the change in drop number, in liquid water path with the change in drop number concentration, now evaluated as delta, not as regression coefficients, but with a very different way. And he found this to be mostly negative. Let's have a look. This is now for different quantities. For example, he made it a function of cloud top height. Let me make it a function of the effective radius. That's a green curve. And we see, and it's here, this scale here. And we see at large effective radii, we get a positive number. At small effective radii, we get a negative number. Same again. And let's also look at the brown curve. Relative humidity above clouds. It's more negative if it's dry above the clouds than if it's humid above the clouds. So this is consistent, again, with this idea. The integral thing, it's typically negative, as also Ed found, and it offsets quite a sizable amount of the relative forcing due to aerosol-cloud interactions. Cloud fraction, drop number, cloud fraction as a function of drop number, that's from MODIS data for an exemplary region. We see a positive relationship. That would be a strong positive, strong negative forcing, strong positive effect on the albedo, would add quite a bit to the relative forcing due to aerosol clouds interactions. But we don't know what we're doing here, really, because we do know that at low cloud fraction, drop number is biased low. So there's a couple of things which we need to understand still until we think this is really an effect. Okay, I'm out of time. Let me conclude. I think what's important is we have a couple of key cloud bulk quantity. The drop number is the fundamental one. Albedo is sensitive to this. It's a monotonic function. Liquid water path, which is basically adiabatically the square of its vertical extent of the cloud. Much stronger sensitivity, cloud fraction, strong sensitivity of the albedo. The terrestrial effect we didn't talk about. Let's consider the effects of extra drop number concentration. First, we have a depletion of supersaturation. And that's also something which I didn't have the time. Yeah, we have depletion of supersaturation that would increase the buoyancy, the increase the virtual temperature, and that would lead to larger geometrical thickness, sometimes called invigoration of warm clouds that we didn't talk about. The dispersion effect, the position grows proportional to 1 over r, narrowing of the spectrum. Autoconversion rate strongly nonlinear in the effective radius or the droplet radius, reduced rate of loss of cloud water, larger cloud fraction in particular, also liquid water path. The lifetime effect, enhanced cloud top cooling, enhanced end-to-end mixing, reduced liquid water path, and that's basically, again, the equation for the effective forcing, the relative forcing, the adjustment of cloud fraction, adjustment of cloud liquid water path, and then that basically the attempts to quantify these from data. Now, what's challenges? A couple of things. Partial derivative, we need to hold cloud regimes fixed. So that's a challenge. We probably need to do better than ordinary least squares regression. And also we should try and avoid retrievals and try to get rid of these caveats, which I alluded to. And with that, many thanks for your attention.
Thank you. Thank you, Johannes. Very nice talk. And I think it is going to get a lot of attention now. There are a couple of questions. Maybe Mahin, can you please?
There is a question. There are actually a couple of questions from Subrata Mukherjee. He's asking whether the effect of anthropogenic aerosol will be different for warm phase and mixed phase cloud. If yes, how?
Yes. So there's a couple of points here, obviously. First of all, let us consider the Toomey effect, this fundamental thing, the change in cloud droplet concentration. Fundamentally, it would be similar for a supercooled liquid cloud as well. And if at the top of that mixed phase clouds we have supercooled liquid, that's what matters really for the Toomey effect, for the relative forcing. So first of all, the first answer is for the fundamental thing, the change in drop number, it does not matter. We can also consider mixed phase clouds. When it comes then to this adjustment, to the changes in cloud fraction and cloud liquid water path, it's a different story. We cannot do it by, I mean, first of all, this entrainment mixing aspect, again, is the same. So we can use that same concept. The autoconversion aspect, this cloud lifetime effect, that's not the same. Because obviously mixed phase clouds, the precipitation formation is different. It is via Bergeron-Finteisen, via the ice phase. And as you know, by far most precipitation in over continents and over the mid-latitudes, it's formed via the ice phase. So that's a fundamental thing, that this is very different. Do we have simple concepts? I don't yet.
Thank you. He has another question. Is an increase in anthropogenic aerosol emission somehow influenced by lightning intensity or occurrences?
Okay, that's a topic which I did not address here in this talk because obviously you need, first of all, deep convective clouds, and as you know, probably you need precipitation formation via mixed phase and via ice phase. So that's what you need for lightning to be generated. Is lightning a function? Can it be, or is it partly a function of pollution? There is strong indication that yes.
Yeah. During the start of the talk, there was a question, but actually you already have shown. He was asking Jeevan Kumar Bordola, how we can see the aerosol role in climate and energy budget. Could you please comment?
How we can see it in the sense of can we observe it, I guess that's the point. Yeah. Can we directly observe it? Because I hope I have shown that we can indirectly observe it. We can observe also large scale. We can see the trends in drop number concentration. Ribusherian published a nice paper on this last year, 2020, Geophysical Research Letters. So we can see this effect on drop number concentration, large scale, and the consistency with the aerosol change. So that we can see. can we see the change in albedo? As you know, clouds are very noisy. So the signal to noise ratio when it comes to trends in albedo is not very good. Yeah. So there is now the first hints at some evidence of an aerosol effect in the albedo, but it's not yet evident that we very clearly can see it in the albedo trends. Yeah. We don't expect it necessarily, as you know. We do not clearly see it in broadband. We do not clearly see the greenhouse effect in radiation. I mean, we start to see it now, but just saying, the aerosol effect is also subtle and not so clearly seen in the radiation fluxes. Clear sky radiation fluxes, I should say. It's a clear signal in the clear sky radiation. It's in the clouds where it's more noisy.
Yeah, Mahin,
there is another question. Yeah, Gaurav Govardhan is asking, how would aerosol cloud radiation interactions affect aerosol ERF?
Effective radiative forcing.
Yeah, effective radiative forcing.
The total one or the total effective forcing? What's meant? Is it the role of the aerosol radiation interaction, so direct effect on the aerosol cloud interactions, or is it meant the total aerosol effective forcing on the total overall effective forcing?
I think overall you can.
Yeah. So that is, of course, one of the important conclusions of the recent IPCC report, the sixth assessment report, if you like. One of the key messages is now, of course, compared to AR5, so with 8 years more of data and also some developments, obviously, in science, now we see clearly that 100% of the total effective forcing, of the total drivers of climate change, is due to humanity. So there's basically two things only remaining that explain the full effective forcing, which is the greenhouse effect due to the various greenhouse gases. Land use is a minor player, and aerosols. So so about half a Kelvin, half a degree Celsius, of the total warming today compared to pre-industrial is 1.2 degrees Celsius. About half a degree Celsius is cooled by the aerosols, and so 1.7 degrees Celsius is the warming due to greenhouse gases, to the various greenhouse gases, with the others now neglected. The effect by sun and volcanoes is zero, if that hopefully explains. So that's the best estimate of IPCC, which, as you know, maybe had an aerosol, total aerosol effective forcing of minus 1.3 watts per square meter. And translating this into degrees Celsius warming, which was nicely done in the chapter seven of the IPCC report, you see half a Kelvin cooling due to aerosols, and then so much warming due to greenhouse gases that we get these 1.2 degrees Celsius warming.
Thank you. I think this answers this question. There is another question from Nilam. How does the cloud radiative forcing looks due to presence of layered clouds, the layered clouds?
Yeah, that's a very important question. As you saw, and maybe you were also a little bit disappointed, I don't know, I did not distinguish very much between layered clouds and cumulus clouds. As some of you at least know, satellite retrievals are much easier and much more reliable for layered clouds than for cumulus clouds. And in particular, that problem, which I highlighted, of we do not know what's that term, the cloud fraction change with the drop number change. That's due to the fact that in particular for these cumulus clouds, we do not know exactly, I mean, that we do not really trust the retrievals. And so because low cloud fraction means more cumuliform clouds, high cloud fraction means more layered clouds. So what we get here is an uncertain cloud fraction response. There's another aspect of the answer, if I may, and that is to do with the fact that when we have the Toomey effect for the radiative forcing due to aerosol cloud interactions, and when we want to quantify it from satellite observations, and that has to do with the thing that you do not see aerosols from satellite if there are clouds. And so in former studies, very often, we would not be able to diagnose an aerosol forcing for situations with a lot of layered clouds. Yeah, and that is by a postdoc who's now in Leipzig, Heiling Jia, Nature Communications papers this year, where she demonstrated neglecting this is very important because these layered clouds, these extensive layered clouds, they have a strong aerosol forcing. And we need to consider these. And the solution which she presented is make use of reanalysis data. So the reanalysis, the model in the reanalysis, the atmospheric composition reanalysis, accounts for these gaps in satellite retrievals.
Thank you. Yeah.
Mahen, now let us take questions from our panel here.
Yes. Yeah, Dr. Pandacharai. Yeah.
Yeah, thanks. Thank you, Johannes, for a very crispy talk. We enjoyed really. I have one question. It's like, what is our level of understanding on the cloud lifetime effect or the effect of aerosols on cloud liquid water path? So the effect of aerosols on droplet number is linear. So whereas the effect of aerosols on liquid water path, so it's not very linear relationship. So what fraction of this cloud lifetime effect is contributing to this effective radiative forcing, cloud radiative forcing?
Yeah, very good question, obviously, and you saw me a little bit struggling with this, with a clear answer on it. I guess we have concepts, nice concepts for a cloud that where we know it's mainly due to autoconversion, its lifetime, and we also have nice concepts but we know precipitation does not matter. It's due to evaporation. But what's the overall thing? What's real? What's in the atmosphere? We only can know it from empirics. We need to observe it. We need to get this from observations. Now, the two approaches which I presented here, we can look at the satellite data from statistics, from regressions. And these seem to point to an overall negative relationship, that overall this mixing is a relevant process. And we also, this other approach is looking at tracks, these natural laboratories, as we sometimes call it now, experiments of opportunity or what people call it. And that also seemed to point to the similar direction. Is that now the answer? I guess, unfortunately, not yet the complete answer. Of course, I mean, like, the research has to go though, isn't it? So, pieces of the puzzle, and there are some pieces of the puzzle. And but I think, sort of, had I given this talk a year ago, I would have been more confident. Now, with more research, you saw the paper by the group from Graham Feingold, Glassmeyer in Science, that criticized the track approach, because if you look at a track, we look at a very short snapshot, only a part of the lifetime of a cloud, so that might overestimate the sink aspect. If you look at the regression, we have a couple of sorts of difficulties, in particular, where exactly do we diagnose the drop number, and is it really, can we really assume approximately one number, and where exactly to diagnose it, and can, is this really the metric that tells us about the forcing? So there's a couple of reasons not to trust this too much, but at least sort of if you would force me to give an answer, then I would say the evidence right now still is that it reduces, there is a negative adjustment.
Thank you.
Johannes, also this liquid water path observations are erroneous when it is coming to very low, like very thin clouds, as well as very when in presence of precipitation. So that would introduce also significant uncertainty when considering the estimates, right?
That's true. That is true. That's very important. So whenever there's not much in the atmosphere, then all the passive sensing has its difficulties. And you're right. That's very problematic.
There may be more questions now from the
panel. No, there are no more questions in the YouTube.
Yeah, I have.
OK, Marcy. Yeah, Marcy.
Yeah, I'm Padma. I'm Jonas. Yeah, it's very interesting talk. It's really, I have a few, one question, like satellite-based cloud properties are always underestimated when we compare with the ground-based remote sensing. So, and in most of the studies, we have seen there's a lot of underestimation. And then this may in turn lead to large biases in relative forcing estimates also. So in order to study aerosol cloud interactions using satellite observations, so we may require some coincident aerosol cloud retrievals. I think it is highly difficult to identify such cases and do it. So what is your suggestion or opinion? How do we go about this?
Yes. I think we need to move forward and improve step by step our understanding of these individual things. I think in here and there we were able already to improve what we're looking at, so I don't think there's a general solution. So as you one thing is the aerosol, and a proposition when it comes to better assessment of the aerosol was to use this polarimetric retrievals to also know about the sphericity of the particles, and to know have at least some idea about the size distribution of the particles. So these additional pieces of information from polarimetry when it came to the aerosol were what was the key conclusion by Otto Hasekamp. The other big quantity is the drop number concentration, and for the drop number concentration there is shortcomings, and then I think what we need is to dig deeper and understand better and improve the retrievals so that we get a more and more reliable answer here. But you're right, I mean, so far we deal with the data we have, and we do know in a couple of cases we do know the deficiencies. One of the things was what Tara just said, thin clouds, or also what I also alluded to, thin aerosol layers, that's very problematic. Yes. What I also said, for example, broken clouds, yeah, plenty of problems.
yeah, and also sampling biases that one has to take care of doing comparisons and all.
Yes, yeah. That was the question about the layered clouds. Yeah, that's very important.
Yeah. Thank you for an excellent talk.
Yeah, Marcy has waved his hand.
Yeah. Hi, I'm Marcy. I've dealt morely with observations than with models. So one feedback you asked for, it was very useful. You giving the equations of the forcings and the feedbacks and all, it was new to me, and I was very much happy that someone was there to explain this. So one of my main doubt regarding this modeling about the perturbations in clouds from the aerosols, as you said, most of those are related to the bulk quantities, and the effective radius of these clouds is also changing when you have perturbations from the aerosols. And you have seen, you have shown those studies by yourself and others towards the end, where they have also a relation with the bulk quantities used, that is the LWC or the optical thickness. So how are these being incorporated into the models? Like you said, is it just the linear regression? Because that also keeps changing with the type of cloud as well as where the cloud is formed, like that.
Yes. So that's a good point, and maybe I should have highlighted early on that theoretical framework, these equations which I showed, this is in general a simplified framework. It is basically to try and put some mathematical rigor and some explanations into these concepts so that you can formalize plenty of these concepts. That is not the way it is exactly done in the models. So an atmospheric model is of course three-dimensional or four-dimensional, if you like, three-dimensional space and the time dimension. And it does not, for example, describe the cloud by one number liquid water path, but it uses the profile of the liquid mass. It also does not consider just one number for the top number concentration, but it uses does this vertically resolved, etc. So depending on what model you have, and then these other equations, they are in the model. And so it's not like these terms are immediately directly the parameterization of the model, but the model has other equations that treat it. Maybe would be worth to talking about how a model is constructed. But these equations are not immediately implemented in the model. One thing which you specifically talked about is the effective radius. And I think I did this only implicitly in my talk. I think it is problematic. The reason to use the effective radius in studies is because it was there. I think it's purely historical reasons. The effective radius is an important quantity when it comes to simplified radiative transfer. And it is very problematic when it comes to analyzing aerosol cloud interactions, because you convolve two different effects. The effective radius is a function of the drop number, Toomey effect, and liquid water path adjustments. And depending on what happens in the cloud, the size is not really reflecting the Toomey effect, nor the adjustments. It's a convolution of the two. And so I think one key thing which I try to do in my formalism here is get rid of this drop size of the effective radius, because it is so ambiguous. Sometimes you need it, yeah. In some processes, you need to know about the size, like autoconversion, for example, or concentrational growth, there you need it. So you could also formulate it in terms of drop number, of course, but it's problematic.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you.
I have also invited one student. She's there in the... does she have any question, Janani?
Is somebody here from Germany?
No, nobody. Is there anyone from Germany? No. No, I invited...
Maybe via YouTube, yeah.
Okay. I think she is not answering. So Johannes, what is your impression about the... Just one thing. What is your impression about the... in an in situ measurement, for example, we see a significant variability in any of these parameters that we discussed. So the clouds are very ever changing, and they are quite variable in nature. And in that respect, don't we think that there is a second order effect that we should consider in even in the radiative forcing also?
Yeah, so of course there's great value in the in situ observations. After all, how can a satellite flying 400 kilometers above the clouds and then having a footprint of at least a kilometer squared, how can that be accurate when it comes to microphysical quantities? So really the only way to know what's really going on in a cloud is by flying into it. And as you know, my nice colleague Manfred Wendisch, he is also part of this endeavor of looking into the clouds, and the colleagues at Tropos as well. So really, to know what's going on, we need in situ. Can we directly learn from in situ to about the global effective radiative forcing? I think it's challenging because, as you say, there's such a large variability. We understand, ideally, we understand exactly and observe and try to see new processes, things we don't know, things which are surprising from the aircraft. And then we need some way upscale to translate what we learn from the aircraft, to translate it into learning about climate. But I guess the short, there's probably no shortcut, or at least I don't see a simple shortcut directly from the aircraft to the global climate. That's why satellite data for global climate, because of their global coverage, are useful, but with all the uncertainties which we discussed in this discussion.
And I have not seen that in your studies are you using Calypso any time?
Yes. So sometimes you really need Calypso and CloudSat. One prime example is when it comes to ice clouds, because many of these simple concepts for radiative transfer, they fail when you look at ice clouds. And one thing which I did show here is we also want to understand, obviously, how do ice clouds and mixed phase clouds, how do they react to the aerosol perturbation? And so we need the ice crystal number concentration. And that is much better from active remote sensing. So what we use is the combination of CloudSat and Calypso to get to the ice crystal number concentration and then learn about its perturbation. So that's one example. Or we have a regional focus on the Arctic climate change. And when you look at the Arctic, you run into lots of troubles with passive remote sensing. So there again, one requires the active remote sensing because it's not, you're not hampered by the inversion or by the bright surfaces, but you just can look into the clouds from active.
Yeah. Yeah, thank you. And are there any more questions for
Mahin? No, there is no.
No more. So, shall we then thank Johannes profusely and accepting our invitation? And thank you so much. And we are very, very happy to have you, and maybe some of the topics that you could not talk today, maybe we will invite you again.
Many thanks. Yes, thank you so much. Thank you very much for organizing this series.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for the opportunity.
Yeah.
Goodbye.
Another talk today. Thank you.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. Look forward to that. Yeah. Very nice.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you, everyone.
Yeah. Bye.
Thank you.